Dance for Programs. It's a four-section or four-session volume, whatever you want to call it, program. Volume one, once they're in book form, they'll be volumes, but right now they're kind of sessions, I guess you'd call them. Ideally, we would have had them all written in book form when this information was released, but because of things we'll talk about in the Metatronic workshop that's coming up day after tomorrow, it all had to be released fast. It would have been very, very irresponsible for us to not release as much as we had as quickly as possible, because there are some things happening that it will be in your best interest to have this information as soon as possible, even if it's not in its most perfected form. So when they're in book form, they will be volumes, and I'm almost afraid to think of how many pages those volumes might be if this is just the rough workshop manual. Because I remember Kathara started out as a rough workshop manual, and we have 220 pages in just Kathara level one. So it may, you know, they may grow that large. But basically, they're broken down into a series of four levels of study, and they are sequential, where I wouldn't want to be somebody trying to come in over here, because you need to do the activations that go with each level. Each level, you will get a certain set of codes that are mathematical programs that will assist your DNA to activate in very specific ways. It's the fastest DNA activation program on the planet. It's the original DNA activation program on the planet. It's the Founders program, and it's the Christos program, which is very different than other ones that try to get certain levels of the DNA activated and not on a D12 current. D12 always refers to your, what they call the Christos frequency, the D12 divine blueprint, pre-matter, liquid light frequency. All of the programs from Kathara Healing, you know, the other Kathara Healing program we have, to all of these, all run on a D12 carrier wave, which means if we can't access D12 frequency, none of these programs will work in the body. You cannot build the Akasha Merkabah without a minimum of D12 being able to run through you. So everything here is built on a D12 Christos frequency and higher. We work with the higher frequencies of the God worlds as well that we'll cover very, very quickly. The D12 and higher frequencies, the Christos frequencies, and those that will allow you to, first of all, remember what the heck the God worlds are and maybe why you might want to go there, and be able to bring that into a reality in your body, not just as a wishful thinking or a hope or a dream that you might someday be able to do this thing that some people call ascension, but bring the reality of ascension back. This is an ascension course. But it's not an ascension course that has you doing 20 Hail Marys and bowing down to Archangel Michael in order to get yourself someplace that you hope is where God lives. It's a way to remember who you are and to remember that you were never separated from God in the first place. However, your body is as much a part of your relationship to God as you are. And your body, our bodies on this planet have been our prisons for a very long time because we have had the information on how to work them properly taken away from us. We have also had genetic mutations that were done that made us literally imprisoned in our bodies, where we had to die instead of ascend. This is changing. It's not going to change overnight, but this is going to be the first wave, the first generation of people in the last 25,000 years who have had the information given back to them that will make that a plausible reality. Not everybody is going to have enough time in this ascension cycle to fix the bodies enough to get them through a gate, but your consciousness can still go. And if you end up in a situation, whether or not you can fix your body enough to get your DNA back to where it needs to be to actually be able to go through a stargate without blowing up, because that's what happens. You take a body that can't hold frequency through a stargate, and it will spontaneously implode. And that means your consciousness gets fragmented all over the place, and that's not what you want to happen. So some people will do the traditional, or what's traditional in the last 25,000 years, which is die the body. That's okay, as long as you know how to do it. You leave that behind and get your consciousness through a gate, incarnate into a higher cycle up where you don't have to come down here anymore. All right, that's the least you'll get out of this program. The most you might get out of this program, and it's not something I can promise you or that I can even promise myself or ask and promise myself himself or anything, because there's so much work that needs to be done in these bodies, and there's not a whole lot of time and a whole lot of support down here right now that's going to help us do that. But we may be able to literally walk through a stargate. That has been something that has been denied human beings since Atlantis. In Atlantis, there was a limited potential to do that because the grids were damaged ever since 208,216 BC. That's like 200,000 years ago. That's, you know, way before the Atlantis story, which was only 9,558 BC when it ended. The potentials that are being brought back to us now are phenomenal. They're unprecedented in anything that we call history here right now. If I didn't know the truth of these things, if I hadn't been physically, with a lot of help, dragged into inner earth, you know, And there was DNA activations done on my body to make me be able to go through those portals. There were also buffers put around me called spaceships that were allowed to take me through, because spaceships serve one purpose. If you can't fully build a Merkaba yet, there are certain vessels that will provide some degree of protection in going through gates where you can temporarily go, but you can't stay on the other side unless your body can hold the frequency. So anyway, the things that I'm talking about with ascension, this is not some light, love, and clueless class. It is a class that's going to teach you. You are going to be your own best teacher. And by the time you get done understanding the fact that you're an avatar and remembering what that means, you're not going to want anybody to pray to. You don't need to pray to anybody. You can love God and you can ask God for help, sure. But do it with dignity, for goodness sakes. You don't have to grovel before God. We're taught to grovel before false gods in our culture since Atlantis, since they took our books and they mutilated them. There's nothing wrong with praying if it's done with self-dignity. You can say, hey, I love you, God, and I know you're bigger than me, and that level has so much more, and I know I'm a part of you, and I know you love me. And would you please help me out with this one? I figured it out as much as I can, and I'm stuck. Would you please help? You can have this kind of relationship with God. You don't have to go cut the head off a goat and drip its blood someplace in order to please God enough that it might pay attention to you. This was the old way. You don't have to go to a priest and beg his forgiveness, especially if he's messing with altar boys. couldn't resist. I couldn't. You don't need intermediaries. This course is about how to get there without the intermediaries. And once you get that taste of freedom and dignity back, you look at what's going on in the rest of the world and you start to see how twisted it is. And it's only then, when you start to feel the freedom that emerges inside of you, that you begin to see what you're walking around in on this planet. This planet has been a prison planet since 25,500 BC. The only people in the universe that don't know that are the people who live here. Interesting. It's been a mind control planet since the Anunnaki came in and took over and programmed things in here that didn't belong here. This is a time of freedom and of bringing our freedom back to ourselves. And it doesn't start with first necessarily knowing the big political drama that we're right smack in the middle of right now in our time frame, because we are. It starts with knowing your parts, knowing you. There was a saying once upon a time of, know yourself and you'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free. The person who said that was a person we call Joshua 12. Some people call him Jesus Christ. Some people say he died on a cross, which he didn't. He taught this. We know that because we were incarnate at the same time, and we knew this person, and we helped teach this. That's why we're back doing it again. So these are the original Christian teachings. And they weren't just the teachings of Jesus. They were Magi, the Grail Line, Indigo Children, all through history. We're the ones commissioned with bringing these teachings back, keeping the gene codes alive, so the 12-strand and higher DNA template would be available for the human being. So we didn't lose the ability to be Christos beings. So no matter how lost we might have gotten densities down here, we'd be able to get found again. These are the teachings that are the freedom teachings. What's a little hard about the freedom teachings is once you really get a taste for them, you start to work with the techniques, and the techniques aren't that hard. It's just like, what's the hardest about all this is learning why the techniques work and why they're important. The techniques themselves are not that difficult. What is challenging is the theory that goes with them. What is a Weka code? You know what I mean? You know, what is a Maharada ray? You know? What is a Manu? I mean, there's all these new words. Yeah. Once we learn those words, it's not that difficult. We hope that you will find that little tickle of spiritual freedom, a little part of yourself that remembers enough to say, oh my God, there's freedom there. There's something here that I can go places that I always thought I could, but they always told me I couldn't. You can. You can take your body through a Stargate, or you can call it an ascension passage if you want to. Doesn't matter, Stargate, ascension passage, they're all the same thing. This is the beginning of an opening that's going to occur. The people who get to experience that opening will be the ones who have done the work. The work involves conscious evolution, getting control of your energy, part of which is your body. That's what these teachings are for right now. These teachings, technically, we should have had 25 years to be able to bring through. It wasn't until September of 2000 that the political events surrounding this planet at this time went in a direction that required absolute immediate get the teachings out as fast as possible, because there's some nasty stuff going down here and people really need to be able to fortify their fields fast. That's why it's all being thrown at people right now. Here it is, you know, do what you can with it. You know, we get it down as best as we can and as clear as we can right now. But you will have the techniques, and the techniques are simple. Some people say, wow, I learned all that. All this stuff is really great. I mean, that's all I got to do. I just have to do those four things. I can just use that technique and that technique and that technique. And they're really not that hard. I can take like 20 minutes out of a day, and that's going to get me to ascension, really. It's like I don't have to go up in a monastery for 6 months and like eat once every 3 weeks and, you know, say Om 5 billion times or anything. No, you don't have to do that. But you do have to work with the techniques. They're like a bicycle leaning up against the garage. If you want to get somewhere on it, you have to get on it and ride it. And that's what this course is about. It's teaching you where your bicycle is. You know, you've had it all along. You just kind of like stuck it in the garage and it got buried behind other things. So the Dance Four programs have Dance for Life, which was one. It's called Mastering the Nadahuva Body. Nadahuva Body. A Huva Body is a three-dimensional tritone energy field. Our bodies are composed of them. We'll talk a little bit about them. They're basically talking about the parts of the auric field, each dimensionalized level, and they go in sets of three. So the Nadahuva Body is the first level, dimension one, two, and three. So the first part of this dance, the Dance Four programs, the Dance for Life, is in beginning to master the energies of your dimension 1, 2, and 3 level self. Dimension 1, 2, and 3 encompasses your physical body as you know it here on D1, your D2 emotional body, that thing we call emotions or E-motion. That has to do with your strand 2, your second dimensional frequencies. That is your emotional body. And then you have your mental body, which is your D3 level. All of them are levels of consciousness. This is a level of consciousness too, even though it's consciousness that right now we identify as matter. Each of the levels of your consciousness has its own version of matter. So you have a mental body, a tangible emotional body, and a whole bunch of bodies up above that. So when we talk about Huva bodies, we're talking about the three-dimensional energy fields that hold our consciousness. What they're composed of and built upon are those scalar wave things I talked about before. Each of the Huva bodies has a template that's part of a larger template that's your divine blueprint. That template of scalar waves holds your consciousness into form. That's how you get your consciousness down here, where you can experience a three-dimensional holographic perception that you call 3D reality. So this one's dealing with the first level. It's called density one, dimensions one, two, and three. Now, we're doing radial body activation. Radial body is interesting. The radial body is the part of the anatomy that actually has a huge effect on controlling the rest of the multidimensional anatomy. For about 2 years, we've been working on bringing the different pieces of the multidimensional anatomy into a sequential understanding, where we'll cover that really quickly in Dance for Life. We have some of the graphs from Kathara. If anybody wants to investigate it more fully, the Kathara Biospiritual Healing System gives you, it's exhausting, actually, it gives you everything from the context of healing, which is dimensional structure, primal substance, primal order, all of that, with all the small writing that goes with it, and then it takes you into the levels of your body, takes you into your core template, which is called a Kathara grid, takes you into the three levels of the Kathara grid, starts with the thing that looks like the tree of life with the 12 centers on it, and it builds up from there, takes you into chakras, axiatonal lines, all of the things that you hear healers talk about out there. So Kathara healing takes you more in-depth into those. We will touch upon them here so you see where they fit. Because if you don't know your anatomy, you're not going to know where to run what current, even if you know the names of currents and what they're about. Our subtle bodies hold the blueprints for the physicality of our bodies here. It's because of distortions in the DNA template that manifest as distortions within different levels of the subtle bodies that we have distortions in our matter bodies, where we're about, I think it's about three times as dense as we're supposed to be. The matter here is not supposed to be, and this whole system is not supposed to be as dense as it is. The matter here has become a prison because it's overladen with frequency that's built up and can't move. When we work with the frequencies in any of these courses, we're beginning to move that energy. We're beginning to turn it back around so it can pass through and open up the channels of frequency. So we are making changes in not just our spirit. We are bringing our spirit through in order to make changes in our mental, emotional, and physical bodies. And what's so great about it is you don't have to worship anybody. You don't have to ask any angel. You don't have to ask any ascended master to do it for you. You don't have to call upon the lords of karma. You don't have to call upon anybody except your own crystal self, the part of you that's always lived with its consciousness stationed in D12. Part of you left up there in those frequencies to get down here. It's been with you all along, and it's you, it's nobody else. That part's directly connected to source. This is what this program is about, is getting that part of your consciousness back into your body here so it can fix what's gone wrong in your particular life frame down here, so you can have the freedom that you were given at, you know, that you were actually born into this time matrix with. We have Dance for Life, 12 lessons of mastery, 12 attitudes of mastery, and 12 actions of mastery. Now, they're not the only 12 lessons of mastery in the universe, but they're 12 good ones. They're not the only 12 attitudes either, but they're 12 good ones, or a good place to start. And they're not the only 12 actions by far, but they're all a good place to start. There is only one consciousness in the whole entire cosmos. There's only one identity in the whole entire cosmos. And that is you. That is God. There is no difference. But when God puts itself in pieces down here, especially if it allows part of its DNA to be turned off, it completely forgets that. And then we walk around thinking, you're different than me. Well, I like you because you're similar to me, but I don't like you because you're very different from me. We forget that we are that one consciousness. I am you, you are me, we are the seats we're sitting on, we are the bugs that are crawling on the floor, they're so tiny we can't see them. We are the fallen angelics. They are all the we. If we know ourselves as God, there is not a thing that is outside of what we are. So therefore, that there is not a thing that is not lovable, that is not self. There is no other. There is no us versus them. There is only one. This is part of the understanding that at first it sounds like words. The mental body goes, cool. Bless you. Yeah, that kind of sounds right. Yeah, some part of me knows that. The emotional body goes, flatline. Mental body's gone. Yeah, okay. Emotional body is kind of like, doesn't compute. Okay, I'll buy that. That sounds really great. That means we can just love everybody, right? Like love in clueless space. That's the first reaction. Just love everything. You know, go up to a tiger and hug it, even if it's still on a meat-eating program where it's going to rip your face off. You know what I mean? Open your heart to a fallen angelic and let it take full possession of your body so you never see yourself again. I mean, if you want to, you can do it this way. The emotional reality of oneness cannot fully be experienced down here in the bodies we have as they're functioning right now. But it can be touched. It can be touched enough to know its reality, and it can be expanded to a point where you can walk around and look at other people and see all of their faces at the same time, all their incarnations, and know they're you. You could look at me and know that I'm you. And I can look at you and know the same. That's when it gets fun. You know, see, it's very challenging, especially if somebody's like the mugger that's going to come and steal your purse kind of thing, right? And stop for a moment and say, I'm you, and you're me. Why am I stealing from myself? You know, this is one of the lessons. If you start to ask yourself these questions, the hologram starts to change. If somebody comes up and smacks you, you say, why'd you do that? You're a bad person. Why would you ever do that to me? You say, why did I just smack myself? What am I trying to teach myself? What am I showing myself here? This is what part of being accountable for your hologram is about. You either manufacture this hologram because you are a face of God that is right now on autopilot, manufacturing a hologram to walk around in, or we're in a universe where we have no control, we're in a harsh universe that inflicts itself upon us. It's either one way or the other. And you either take responsibility for the whole thing or you don't. As long as you have 1 ounce of blame left, if you're going to blame anybody, blame the government, blame the fallen angelics, blame your husband, blame your kid, blame anybody. Even if they're the ones that are playing the role of, yes, they're the one that did it. Because there are people who, yes, play the victimizer and others play the victims. If you want to get beyond that game, you own both parts. I am God. I am one with God. That means I am both victim and victimizer. That being is demonstrating a part of myself for me. So you take the charge off the other person. And bring it home and say, what am I trying to learn? How do I heal this? There's a level of oneness that's about accountability. The changes we're going to begin to make, the changes that involve being accountable, saying no matter how awful my hologram is, and no matter how much I really, really could hate that person because they just killed somebody I love, and I know they held the gun, they did it, they really, really, really did. If you can look at that person and say, and that's a face of me, no matter how much it hurts, that is a face of me. Drill that into your head. You'll start to get the oneness, what it means. There's power in responsibility. If you want the power, you need to take the responsibility. I think you guys know that already, though, so that's fun. Now, I think I will go through the graphs because these work easiest. I will describe.
From the Lord of the Rings, the Fellowship of the Ring, Enya.
May it be an evening star, shines down upon you. May it be when darkness falls.